Okay, then we have tubular secretion next. So we're switching gears. Now we're secreting. So now we're looking at solutes that were not filtered at the glomerulus. So let's use green again here. You have plasma that comes in the afferent arterial into the glomerulus, but it does not get filtered. It goes back to the efferent arterial. Then it's passing into the peritubular capillaries and it's on its way back to the heart. But lo and behold, whoa, some of it gets secreted into the lumen of the nephron, okay, the tubule. So what gets secreted? Hydrogen ions are going to get secreted, and remember we already talked about their secretion in the proximal tubule. So now we're going to talk about their secretion in the distal and collecting tubules as well. Potassium ions are also going to be secreted, and this is controlled, so it's controlled by aldosterone. And then we have some organic anions and cations as well. Okay, so let's focus on potassium here for a moment. So once again, we're going to start where we always do, basolateral membrane here. And so we have number one, which is our primary active transport. So we know that sodium is at a low concentration and potassium is at a high concentration inside of our cell. So potassium is at a low concentration out here in the interstitial fluid. Okay, so we want to reabsorb it. So let's start out in the plasma. In the plasma, we have a high concentration of potassium. So potassium is diffusing through, remember the pores between the endothelial cells of the capillary? Potassium diffuses through from a high concentration toward a lower concentration. Then we pump it in using primary active transport. Then it goes through a channel on the apical membrane. So this is the apical membrane. Because it's going through a channel and because it's going from a high concentration to a low concentration, that's called facilitated diffusion. Okay, so now what we've done is we've talked about potassium reabsorption in the proximal convoluted tubule. We've also talked about potassium secretion, which is what we've just now done, in the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting ducts. Okay, so we're reabsorbing and we're secreting potassium. It's a little bit odd, right? So think about the net effect of these. We are going to reabsorb more potassium than what gets secreted. Let's take a look at how that's going to happen. So in this flow chart, you guys are already very familiar with the Renin-Angiotensin System, and that's what part of this is, or all of it actually. It's just a very condensed version. So when you have low salt, low extracellular fluid volume, and low blood pressure, then that's going to end up stimulating your sympathetic response, and the sympathetic response is going to wind up causing the release of renin. Remember, renin is an enzyme, just to give you a quick review, and it's an enzyme synthesized and secreted by the kidneys under the direction of the sympathetic nervous system. So that's going to wind up causing the production of angiotensin 1, which ends up causing that to get converted to angiotensin 2, and angiotensin 2 then stimulates the zona glomerulosa of the adrenal cortex, and that then is going to cause aldosterone release. Okay, so the other thing that causes aldosterone release are looking at the levels of potassium as well as sodium levels. Okay, that's something else that can cause a synthesis or secretion of aldosterone. If you have low sodium plasma, right, or high potassium plasma, we talked about this when we talked about chapter 6, those can both stimulate aldosterone release as well. So you're not solely dependent on the sympathetic or the renin-angiotensin system to release aldosterone. Remember that these controls here, low sodium, high potassium, remember that this is a humoral control. So aldosterone is being released based on the needs of the plasma. Okay, so once aldosterone gets released, aldosterone then is going to increase the number of sodium potassium pumps on the basolateral membrane. So the more pumps you have, the more ions you can move, right? Then aldosterone is also going to increase the number of sodium and potassium channels on the apical membrane. more potassium channels you have, the more potassium secretion you can do. The more sodium channels you have, the more sodium reabsorption you can do, which is what's illustrated in this flow chart. Okay? The more potassium that you secrete, the more that's going to get excreted. The more sodium that you reabsorb, the less sodium that's going to be excreted. Okay, so be sure you understand that terminology. Okay, so the next slide then, this gives you a really nice indication of how aldosterone is actually functioning. So here's aldosterone in the plasma, and you already know how it got there. And so it's going to diffuse into the cytoplasm of the distal convoluted tubule or the collecting duct, and it's going to bind to a receptor. So remember, when this happens, so here's your ligand is aldosterone, it binds to this receptor, and remember you form a hormone receptor complex which binds to the hormone response element on the DNA, and then ultimately you activate a gene. And once you activate that gene, then transcription and translation can take place, and you make protein. So the protein that you're making are these carrier proteins, right? So if you're going to be putting more sodium potassium pumps on the basal lateral membrane, you better be making protein, right? Because you need the pumps. And then the same is true for the apical membrane. You got to make these channels. These are proteins, every single one of these. So you got to activate the gene in order to make those proteins. Okay. So I think that ties in chapter 5 really nicely and brings you back to those intracellular mediated responses.